Hey guys, and welcome to another video. This video will be episode 4 of my Logistics Pipes tutorial series for Minecraft 1.7.10. So the last episode, we talked about how you can request and supply systems from a logistics pipe network, and today I will be talking about how you can auto-craft and auto-process ores. So let's get started. So the things that I want to talk about today are the crafting logistics pipe, the crafting logistics pipe Mark II, and the crafting logistics pipe Mark III, combined with their corresponding crafting modules. So the crafting module Mark II, and crafting module Mark III, and the satellite logistics pipe. So like always, as you can see right here, the red is what I talked about last episode. So if you see anything that interests you right here, be sure to check out the link in the description below to go to the playlist for this video. But otherwise, I will be able to talk about what I want to do today, which is auto crafting. Pretty cool. So as you can see, I got myself a couple of things set up right here. For example, being the logistics fuzzy crafting table and the normal logistics crafting table. There is a slight difference between the two, but I will talk about how all of this thing works in a second. First of all, quickly show you guys the recipes. So this is the recipe for the logistics crafting table, and the logistics fuzzy crafting table is just a normal logistics crafting table with a piece of nether quartz. So pretty much what the idea of these crafting logistics pipes are is that you're able to send items to it, and the pipe will wait for a different item to come out of it. That can mean two things. Either you can use it in a logistics crafting table, meaning that it will pump items into it and craft the recipe that you set in the GUI of this block. Or you can use anything that has an inventory that is able to process ores, for example, let's say, process items, sorry. For let's say a redstone furnace or a pulverizer or pretty much anything that you can put an item into and it changes the item that comes out of it. So yeah, pretty cool. So let's see, what I want to show you first is how you can use the normal logistics crafting pipe. So what you can do is put a recipe in this thing. Either by just, if you have the items in your inventory, selecting them like so. Just let me get some wooden planks, for example. You can just right-click them here to add the recipe. As you can see, a crafting table. You won't be able to take them out as these are ghost blocks, so they aren't actually used up. And you can see the shadowed version of the blocks that you put in here that will be able to use to make the crafting table, just so this pipe knows where to actually put the correct items. Then what you can do is get your wrench and right-click on the crafting logistics table connected to the logistics crafting pipe connected to the logistics crafting table. Sorry. And what you can do is, well, yeah, you will see this little interface. It might look a little bit complicated, but don't worry too much about that. So for these normal crafting tables and fuzzy crafting tables, all you need to do is hit import. And it will automatically select the contents that you put in the crafting table into this pipe. So as I selected to make a crafting table, this thing will automatically say, okay, you added 4 oak wood planks and you get 1 crafting table out of it. Easy as that. So yeah, pretty cool. Also that you can do is hit the open button to automatically open the crafting table that is connected to this logistics pipe. Just so you're able to, for example, hide all of this behind a wall and just have the pipes showing, which is something I did in my previous Let's Play, by the way. Just so you can make things a little bit cleaner. Then, if you wear the logistics heads-up display glasses, which I explained in the first episode, you'll also be able to see the actual output of the recipe that is configured in the crafting logistics pipe. Pretty cool. Then there are two more things in here, which is the satellite frequency, which is something I will talk about in just a minute, and the priority, which is if you have, for example, multiple things of the same recipe, you can set the priority to be either higher or lower, and it will use that recipe first in a more complicated, well, recipe. So what I did is I changed my two swords chest to an ender chest, so I can both put stuff into my system, as easy as that, and request them. So, for example, if I would, let's say, two sword back, I just got two bags corresponding to them and renamed them in an anvil. If I put the wood in here, you'll see it automatically gets sorted in the appropriate chest. And I will be able to remote order it all but one, of course. But you will also be able to see that there is a crafting table in this thing that says 0. That means that it doesn't have any unstuck, but it is able to most likely craft it, or at least has the chance to craft it. So then what you can do is select the item that you want to have crafted, select the specific amount, and hit request. So let's say 5, request, and it will send the items along to the crafting table. It will show you how much it still has to do, and send it to the corresponding path which you selected to send the crafted items to, which is the bag that I selected. Pretty cool, don't you think? I like it. So you might think, okay, that's pretty cool, but what if I want to get like a step closer? Like I'm out of planks, but I do have normal wood. Don't worry, you can use multiple recipes that are embedded in each other. So what I can do is get a, for example, some oak wood and put it in here, and you will see it will say 1 oak wood will make you 4 wood oak planks. Then just hit import on this thing. And then, let's see, where did I put it? Right there. Let's take all of that out and just put some wood in there. Then what I'm able to do is if I want to request some crafting tables, let's say 4, you will see it will take the wood out. It will turn it into wood planks, turn that into crafting tables, and send that to its corresponding pathway. Pretty awesome. And I might ask, well, what would happen if I don't have the appropriate resources? Don't worry, it won't like break or anything. It will just show you a little error message saying like, hey, we don't, or the system doesn't have these specific materials. Which, if you know, if I request it, it will say missing 3 oak wood. So you know exactly what items are missing in your system if you want to autocraft something. Pretty awesome, don't you think? I love it. So let's talk about the difference between the logistics fuzzy crafting table and the normal logistics crafting table. The normal crafting table is used for all your average day crafting. So don't worry too much about your standard recipes because they most likely will work in a logistics crafting table. But there are some exceptions, meaning, for example, things that have a different MBT data. So items that store a specific value, things like tools that have a specific durability that is required. So, for example, a full durability on a specific crafting. That's where the logistics fuzzy crafting table comes in. On its own, it looks pretty simple, like the normal crafting table. But what you can do is right click on any of these slots, or hover over them for that matter, and it will show you the little tab on the left. You can select the specific options per specific spot in this recipe. So as you can see, which ones I select, it will show you the specific color on the outer edge of that thing. So pretty cool. So this thing has 4 different options, like I said. First of all is Ore Dictionary mode. So if you just thinking of random recipes, have something that requires a specific, a specific type of item that another mod also adds, but under a different name, but it has the same Ore Dictionary name and the same recipe, you can select Ore Dictionary on that specific item and it will still function. Then there is the IGN damage, which corresponds to tool damage, for example. So if you want to craft something with a pickaxe, let's say diamond pickaxe uses. Let's pick a cool recipe. For example, a quarry. If you want to make a buildcraft quarry, you will most likely have to use a fuzzy crafting table because it requires a diamond pickaxe, and because otherwise things can get messy with the durability of those tools, you can select to ignore the data. So let's actually select that, for example, like that. If you shift right click in not enough items, hit the recipe on not enough items, and then shift left click on this question mark, it will automatically add the item that you want in here. And you can automatically change the different type of Ore Dictionary. So for example, you can craft pickaxes with different types of sticks, and you can just scroll through them right like so. Or you can left click on the spot and you can automatically see all the different Ore Dictionary types right here and just quickly pick one of them. That's like that. Pretty easy. So like I said, at the recipe for the quarry, then what I can do is select the diamond pickaxe and hit ignore damage. And then if I want to craft a quarry and have the corresponding items, including a diamond pickaxe, I will be able to craft that. Or what you can do, for example, is add a recipe for iron gears, for gold gears, for diamond gears, and a diamond pickaxe, and be able to automatically craft a quarry from raw resources. Pretty cool, don't you think? I think so. But like I said, why just stick to crafting if you want to do things like processing with this? So that's where the other methods come in. For example, the redstone furnace. What I can do in here is select something that I want to have smelted. So let's say cobblestone. But you might ask, well, how on earth would you actually import something? Because, well, you can't import from something like this because it doesn't have a recipe. Yeah, that's where a little different trick comes in. For this, I will be using the crafting modules because with the crafting modules, you're able to set more recipes to one specific block. For a logistics crafting table, that is not really useful because you have to specify the recipe in this block. But for things like a furnace that don't have a fixed recipe, these things are pretty useful. So I got myself a logistics chassis pipe Mark III and a normal crafting module, which I will be able to put in here and hit the question mark, which will show you pretty much the same interface as the normal crafting table. So what you can do is select the items that you would normally get when importing, or hit the import button, which is input one cobblestone, and you will get one piece of stone out of it. Simple, you might ask? Well, yeah, actually it is. So let's put some cobblestone into the system, and let's see, it will show up right there. So let's request all of this stone, because apparently there was already some stone in this system before. Let's get rid of that and the crafting tables. So now, as you can see, it is able to craft some stone, apparently. So let's request 5 pieces of stone. You'll see it sends over the cobblestone that I specified in this pipe. It will try to put it in there, but as you can see, I specified it that the side of this furnace is currently set to not allow to be inputted. So yes, keep in mind that that is important. So if I want to rotate this thing to make the, let's say, backside input, and request it again, or no need to request it again, it will send it over. Then you can see, hey, you were able to put it in because this thing is specified to output only on this side. Sure, go ahead. The cool thing about these pipes is that it is able to auto-extract from most of the inventories that it is able to also send items to. There are some exceptions, but I know that, for example, thermal expansion machines like the redstone furnace work pretty cool with that. So as you can see right now, all the smelted stone is being sent into the request bag right there. Pretty awesome. But then there's also another issue. What if you request more than a stack at a time? So let's get some cobblestone and put it in my network again, a stack, and wait for it to get sorted. Just hit the refresh button to do that automatically. And select just over a stack. Derp, not request cobblestone, I meant request stone. Because otherwise it won't do much. Is it in the system? Yes, there. Let's request just a bit more stone. So on its own it is able to request that because this thing doesn't know it doesn't isn't able to do that. So again, it is able to craft this. But every time it has one spot left, it will send all the remaining items to here and send them all back again when they realize there is no spot left. And, well, that's kind of messy, don't you think? Yeah, I think so too. That's where satellite pipes come in. Satellite pipes allow you to set a specific location for decrafted items to go into. So, for example, this is a little setup that I made right here. Just a regular redstone furnace again, but with a hopper and a chest on top of it. The chest is connected to the satellite pipe, which is configured to satellite ID 1. You can set this to any number that you want. And then there is this logistics chassis pipe again. Let's get another crafting module. Pretty much the difference between the modules and the crafting pipes is just the speed that it's able to craft stuff. So, as you can see on the tooltip, once you hit shift, this one is able to craft one item at a time. The Mark II is able to craft 16 items at a time. And the Mark III is able to craft a stack at a time. So that is pretty cool. So then what I can do is get this module in there. And let's say add a different recipe. Iron to iron ingots. Yeah, makes sense, I guess. So instead of putting them right in the input, I want to set them to put it into the satellite. So satellite frequency 1, this specific section is just for the satellite pipe. Let's say put one item, one iron ore into the satellite. So that is right there instead of this pipe. And you will get one iron ingot out of the crafting pipe. So that is something you definitely want to keep in mind. Satellite is where it will send the items to. And the crafting pipe is where it will get the items out of. Got that? Pretty cool. So let's try this out. To sort back iron ore. Let's actually get 2 stacks of iron ore. Just so I can test the overflow mechanic of this. And craft like 100 pieces of iron ingots. You will see it should send all of it to this corresponding chest up there. It did. And because of the hopper, of course, it sends it down here. Down into the redstone furnace, smelting it. And then the crafting pipe is pulling it out again into the network. So this is pretty much, in this situation, acting like a buffer to prevent you from having overflow and doing too much recipes. And it's definitely something I recommend adding. Especially when you have multiple recipes on a furnace. So if I would add like 3 different crafting cards in here, and for whatever reason I want to craft something that requires 2 different items to be smelted, yeah, that won't go very well unless you have something like this set up. Pretty cool. So yes, that is the main explanation of how you can craft logistics pipes. Then I want to still say one more quick thingy, which is with the remote orderer. Which I kind of glanced over last episode, but didn't get into too much, which is this little both button. Here you can switch the visibility of the items in your network from being able to see all the items that is able to both request and craft. Just show the items that it is able to craft, and just show the items that it is actually able to supply. This is quite handy if you want to double check, like, did I already add that recipe? In case you have like a massive structure with already hundreds and hundreds of crafting tables. Yes, that's something that actually happens to me, for example, because I get way too addicted to auto-crafting. Something like that is very useful to quickly check, like, oh wait, I added that already, so no need to double add that. So yes, that is pretty cool, guys. And with that, I want to wrap up this episode. I definitely hope you guys enjoyed and most importantly found it very educational, which is the main point of this series. Like always, if you have any questions or suggestions, feel free to let me know down in the comment section below. I always read them and I try to respond to them as much as possible, as long as they're kind of relevant, of course. Yeah, pretty cool. So thanks for watching, guys. Please leave a rating and I hope to see you guys all next time. Take care, guys.